Shall I start?
Yes, sir. Now we can proceed.
Yeah. Okay. So our main aim is to calculate the area or volume of a subset of RT. The main idea in calculating the volume or measure of a subset of RD consisting of approximating the subset by union of some other subsets whose geometry is simple and whose volume is whose volumes are known. R2 like squares, rectangles, those things, and in general Rn, open balls like spheres, all those things. So in this talk, we define measure and R case, and we discuss some properties of measure, and we calculate measure of some given subsets of R. Approach. Will be given in this talk. We shall use interval as a building block because we know. So using that, we will calculate, the length or measure of the any arbitrary subset of R. Not all the subsets, like whichever can like possibly calculate. The theory. So now we proceed to give a description of the structure of open sets. Of R. In terms of this is our first theorem 1.
Sir, could you use landscape mode because it's easier to watch over the phone?
No, I didn't get you. What did you say?
Sir, I said that could you use the landscape mode of your screen because it's pretty small for the phone.
Okay. Yeah, sure. So how to do that? You can see my screen. No, how can you guide me how to do?
You have to use landscape mode from notification area. I think from that, I don't know properly, but from the notification area of your tab, I think. Yeah. Could you swipe up from the above? Professor Gurushwami sir has instructed, I think, someone previously in the talk. If he is here, he can tell you.
Yeah, but I haven't seen the talk actually.
Okay, sir, that's no problem. We will adjust. Thank you.
Yeah, for this talk, I will. Somehow, man.
Yeah, please.
From next talk onwards, I will do it that way. What you suggest? Okay. So then I will start. Every open set O of R can be written as. Uniquely. Full union. this time open interval. So anybody know the proof of this theorem? Can you like suggest me the proof? Otherwise I'll give the sketch up. This is basic theorem from real analysis. Can you suggest me how to do for this theorem? Anyone? Okay, I'll give the hint.
You can use the rational numbers, like every open intervals has in real number, they have a countable rational number. So we will use okay.
That will give countable part. So like first we have to show it can be written as union of intervals.
Yeah.
So that we have to show first. Then we have to prove it is like countable number of union.
Yes.
So then, So since O is open, by definition of open set, we know all the points of O are interior point. So for any X belongs to O, there exists a small interval. In balls are intervals here in one dimensional. So there exists small interval such that. So say Ix, such that X belongs to Ix that entirely contained inside the interval O. Okay, so now we define if Ax equal to infimum of all A less than X such that open interval A comma X containing inside O and B of X is supremum of set of all B less than B bigger than X such that X comma B contain inside O. So then we must have AX less than X less than BX. Now choose IX equal to the open interval AX comma BX. Now we have to say this is the largest interval which contains X and contained inside the open set O. Okay, so that we will do later, but for each point, if we take, so for any point X belongs to O, all the points are in, since all the points are interior point, for every X we have such interval IX. So what we will do, we take union X belongs to O and Ix. So this is equal to O since every interval contained inside the O. The way we choose, it contained inside the O. So every interval is subset of O. So if we take union, that is also inside O. Okay, so you open set O, we can write union of I of X, that is def of first. Now we say like if two such interval Ix and Iy intersect, then it must well, that's what we want to suppose. Two intervals Ix and Iy intersect. So two intervals are intersecting, then their union is again interval. So by definition of infimum and supremum, we know this, that Ix is the maximal interval which contains X actually. So since Ix is maximal, we have IX union IY contained inside IX. Similarly, for Y we can do and say that IX union IY contained inside IY. So this happens only if IX equal to IY. So any two intervals IX and IY intersect, they must be equal. Therefore, any two distinct interval in the collection must be disjoint actually. If they didn't intersect, then they must be disjoint. So now we define equivalence relation. Define a relation which is equivalent, you can immediately see. X comma Y belongs to O and X related to Y if IX equal to IY. So now you can write the interval, I mean union as run the index running over equivalence classes. So I will denote equivalence class of X as X tilde. X tilde belongs to, so say this equivalence relation go out IX. So now every intervals are disjoint, in the unions are disjoint. And so there are only countable number of equivalence classes, since like whatever he suggests, like so any interval contains a rational number, since rational is a dense set. So every interval of R contains at least one rational number. Since rationals are countable, so this union also must be countable, because each interval contains at least a rational number, different rational number. So the countability follows from rationals. This completes the proof of this theorem. And this theorem is very important, because we are going to define outer measure, which is like glimpse of this theorem actually. Like so the definition of outer measure immediately captures this idea for idea of open set to the any arbitrary set. About this theorem. If O is open, then by above theorem, there exists open intervals, countable collection of open intervals, such that O equal to union of I equal to J equal to 1 to infinity IJ. So the measure of measure of unions of interval is just union of disjoint interval is just sum of the length of the intervals, no? Like what is the length of, I mean I'm not going to measure, but just in length concern, so what is the length of union of disjoint interval? Just sum of those intervals, no? So that's therefore the measure of O ought to be we can take measure of this open interval as summation of length of this interval. Since this representation is unique, from the theorem, we could measure for open set. Although this provides a natural notion for measure for an open set, it is not immediately clear how to generalize it to other sets in R. So our following definition will give some such extension. So in general it calls outer measure, but in the book which I follows Stein exterior measure, but outer measure and exterior measure both are same. So I'll define the like I will exterior measure as I'm following Stein's circle. So we begin with the definition of exterior measure. So vaguely, the exterior measure M star assigns to any subset of R, to its length actually. M star is a function. So exterior measure M star is a function from subsets of R, some subsets of R, to power positive real number. But it so the proper definition is the following. If E is any subset of R the exterior measure E is given by M star of E equal to infimum of summation j equal to 1 to infinity length of ij, where the E is taken over all countable covers. Meaning E subset of union j equal to 1 to infinity ij, where ij is open intervals. There is always non-negative, but it could be infinity. So in general, as I defined before, as a function, the value of M star of E for any subset E of R lies between 0 to infinity. So now we'll give some examples of some sets whose exterior measure can be calculated. So the example one is very basic example. The exterior measure of a point, so as expected, it is zero. The exterior measure of a point x belongs to R is zero. This is easy to see, since for any epsilon bigger than zero, we know that x belongs to interval x plus epsilon by 2. So then if we take infimum, this is for any arbitrary epsilon, so if we take infimum, it will be zero actually, the length of the interval. So thus singleton x equal to zero. So example two, this is very interesting example. So because we are started from this point, exterior measure of a so it should match for building block actually. Our building block is open interval. So the exterior measure of is length of the interval actually. So it is 2 equal to its length. that is m star of I equal to p minus. So one direction is immediate because I can cover itself. So by definition of exterior measure, so it should be, so since m star of I is infimum of all the covering, so this is also one covering, so the m star of I is necessarily less than or equal to length of the interval I. So now we have to prove the reverse inequality. So to prove this inequality, what we will do, like we'll take any arbitrary covering. We consider I, say like ij union j equal to 1 to infinity ij by integers. Okay, then if length of the interval is less than or equal to summation j the, since the interval is arbitrary collection, it works for infimum all. We have length of the interval I is less than or equal to m star of I. So to prove this inequality, say one, we will take a larger collection and which covers ij also, like which covers I as well as ij. So how will we going to do that? If for a fixed epsilon bigger than zero, for we choose for each j and open kj which contains ij such that kj less than or equal to 1 plus epsilon. Length of kj is like slightly bigger than length of ij. That's we want that. Easy to see that since its length is slightly bigger, it also contains the closed interval because it like epsilon times, I mean it bigger than slightly bigger, so it contains the end points. Easy to see. See that closed interval a comma b is also subset of union j equal to 1 to infinity kj. So now we use compactness as well, since closed interval a comma b is compact, there exists a finite covering, say k1, k2, etc., k capital N, such that closed interval a comma b is subset of union j equal to 1 to n kj. So the length of interval I is less than or equal to, so this length of the closed interval also b minus a, so length of interval I is less than or equal to summation, since this is covering, so we have summation j equal to 1 to n kj, which is less than or equal to summation j equal to 1 to n 1 plus epsilon times ij, and this is less than or equal to the full sum, actually 1 plus epsilon equal to 1 to infinity ij. Now, since epsilon is arbitrary, so we find that the inequality 1 holds for any epsilon actually. So it holds for infimum also, like since epsilon is arbitrary. Inequality one holds, that is less than or equal to summation j equal to 1 to infinity ij holds. So this covering is arbitrary, so we have summation I less than or equal to m star of I. So we already had reverse inequality, so thus m star of I equal to the length of the interval. So also it is easy to see that m star of open closed interval and m star of a comma m star of a, so this side open and this side closed interval is also length of the interval I, that is b minus. So this is small exercise. Example 3. M star of R real number is plus infinity. So this follows from the fact that any covering of R is also covering any interval I subset of R, because I of R. So hence, so we know that outer measure of I is exterior measure of I is just length of the interval. Hence, we know that this exterior measure is less than or equal to exterior measure of R. But I can be arbitrary large actually. So length of the interval may goes to infinity. So for any given real number, we can choose length of that interval. I mean, interval of that length actually. So therefore it must be infinity. Therefore, M star of R must be infinity. So example 4. Let A be countable subset of R. R, then M star of A equal to 0. In particular, M star of rationals Q equal to 0, since that is countable. So can anyone give me the proof? This is very similar to what we are doing before. Any of the participants, if you have had a course in measure theory, then it must be
Suppose hello.
Yeah, go ahead.
So take let x belongs to A, then x is equal to closed interval x comma x. So measure of singleton is zero.
Okay. Yeah. Then, so how you are going to cover individual all the individual element? I mean.
Union countable. Of x belongs to A, countable union.
Countable union. So countable what are you saying? A subset of countable union of, so say A equal to, I enumerate A is like I equal to 1 to infinity AI like that. So what, so how you are going to cover this?
Closed interval AI comma A, oh sir. AI minus epsilon comma AI plus epsilon.
Okay. So then if you sum, so then M star of A is less than or equal to summation I equal to 1 to infinity. What is the length of the interval? 2 epsilon. So then it's like already infinite sum. This is positive. So this is infinity, no? Like we have to choose carefully. So your idea is correct. So what I am doing, so for that, 2 power n plus 1. So epsilon divided by 2 to the power n plus 1. Then what happens? So if we take this, then it will be like 2 by epsilon divided by 2 to the power n plus 1. Then the sum becomes epsilon. So for any epsilon arbitrary, so this is first actually for any epsilon bigger than 0, choose this covering and this is equal to epsilon. Thus, so this is true for any arbitrary epsilon. Thus, M star of A equal to 0. So just yeah, thank you. So example 5. So now we are going to define a uncountable set whose measure is 0, namely Cantor set. You may study this set, about this set in real analysis. So I will define this set here also. So this is 0, 1 interval. So say this interval as C naught. So this is in the beginning. So now first, in the first step, C1, what we are going to do is like, we are going to remove interval of length 1 tat in between this actually. 1/3 to 2/3, we'll remove this part. Then we have this interval. So C1 is union of 0, 1/3 union 1. So since we are removing open interval, the remaining thing is closed. So in the third step, 0, remove 1/3 interval of 1/3 squared length in between in from C1. 1/9 and 2/9 this part, and this already we removed, so this part is there. 2/3, 7/9, and this is 8/9. So only this fourth part is there, so this C2. So C2 equal to union of 0, 1/9 union 2/9, 1/3 union 2/3, 7/9 union 8/9, 1. So if we are doing like this, so after this we will remove 1/3 to the power 3 length interval from the each part actually. So in general we'll get Cn. So if you iterate this step n times, what we'll have is by 3 power n, and then we remove something and we have something here. And like similarly, we have gaps and 1 by the length of interval of 1 by 3 power n. And finally, this is 1 and this is 3 power n minus. And this point is 3 power n minus 2 divided by 3 power n. So this procedure yields a sequence Cn of compact sets. Since all the intervals are closed and bounded, that's why all of them are compact. Say with C1 is bigger because it is 0, 1. And C0 is bigger, it is closed interval 0, 1. And C1 we removed one third interval. Then after that we removed some part. So this is like the sets Cn, and Cn plus 1 next step if we remove, then this is, and we are doing this process for infinite time. So then since this is a decreasing sequence, so the final set is just intersection of all the sets. So that is what Cantor set is actually. Sorry. The Cantor set that C is by definition the intersection of all sequences, all CNs. So C equal to Cantor set is denoted by C. So C equal to intersection of n equal to 0 to infinity C. So we give some remark about Cantor set. C is non-empty. So this intersection is non-empty. All the endpoints must be inside the, so whenever we are removing the points, so this endpoints must be inside the set, no, all the time. So it cannot be empty. So it is non-empty by definition. So I will write the reason also, since all the endpoints of the intervals in CK belongs to CH. All the endpoints the interval Cn belongs to C for any n. The second fact is C is closed and bounded, hence it is compact. So arbitrary intersection of closed set is closed. So C is closed and C is bounded since it is inside the interval 0, 1. So C is compact. Compact non-empty set. And that fact is C is totally disconnected. That is like very important. C is totally disconnected. What does it mean? That is given X comma Y belongs to C, there exists Z does not belongs to C, such that X less than Z less than Y. So for any X comma Y belongs to C, we can find Z. Like this is very simple because so C is intersection of all the CNs. So since point, so distance of X comma Y is like bigger than 0, some epsilon or something. By Archimedean property, we can find the length of, the Archimedean property. There exists n such that 1/3 to the power n is less than epsilon. So if this happens, then we might have removed some interval of 1/3 to the power n plus 1 in between x and y. So there must be a point z lies between x and y. So this is how, like, this is totally disconnected, can be proved actually. Is this clear, or shall I elaborate more? Hello?
Clear, sir.
Is this fine? Oh, okay. So also C is perfect subset of R. Perfect means it is closed and all of its points are limit points actually. It contains no isolated points. That is, it has no isolated points. So this I won't give the proof, and this also you can prove similarly actually. I mean, so if you choose a point and you can find a sequence which converges to that point actually, from the Cantor set. I mean, you can find there are infinitely many points which close to any point in C yet. So that's why C is perfect set. And from the basic course of real analysis, we know that any perfect set is uncountable. So any perfect set must be uncountable. There is no countable perfect sets actually. So therefore, C is uncountable. And now, so now we want to show exterior measure of M star of C is zero. So from the construction of C proof, we know that C contained in Cn, where Cn is disjoint union of 2k closed intervals each of length 3 to the power minus, I mean, sorry, n, this is n and this is also n, okay, minus n. So then M star of C, I mean, C contained in Cn, so M star of C is less than or equal to M star of Cn, which is equal to summation, not summation, 2 to the power, so 2 to the power k times 2 to the power n times 1/3 to the power n. So which is 2/n whole power n. So this is true for any n because Cantor set contained in Cn for all n. So this for all n bigger than or equal to. So since as n tends to infinity, 2/3 power n converges to 0. So then if we take, so infimum of all, so we get M star of C equal to 0. So therefore, Cantor set is an uncountable set whose measure is zero. But I have a remark to say, actually. I will not write. So similar construction, instead of doing of length, specific length, actually, fixing specific length, if we do with arbitrary length, I mean, we remove some length of arbitrary, arbitrary interval of any length, actually, like instead of removing length of 1 over 3 and then 1 over 9, then 1 over 3 power 3. So we can do it in other way also. So in that way also we get some other set which is called Cantor-like sets. And there may be some sets of similar construction whose measure is positive. This I will give us a remark, but I won't write it because the construction is like little more tricky and it takes time. So I'm not giving details about those sets, but instead I will do some properties of exterior measure without proof. Exterior. The first property, monotonicity. This we used in between, but now only I'm giving this. If E1 subset of E2, then E1 less than or equal to M star of E2. First property, and the second property is countable subadditivity. We expect countable additivity, but only countable subadditivity is true. So if E equal to union J, so these are not necessary, disjoint union. So then M star of E is less than or equal to summation j equal to 1 to infinity m star of ej. Even though if we assume this is disjoint, this union, then also we will not have equality. So those examples are given by non-measurable set that we will do in later in the course. But measurable set, if you have disjoint union, countable union of disjoint sets, then the measure of E equal to summation j equal to 1 to infinity measure of E. So that will be come from some specific regularity which we will define later. So now the tag, if E subset of R, then M star of E equal to infimum of M star of R. So M star of where the infimum is taken over
sir counting.
What?
Yeah, sir, that counter subadditivity is not true for even open sets, like when we have that open set. Sir.
No, it is true for open sets. Okay. So countable additivity is true for measurability. I have not defined it actually. I'll be defined in next class maybe in this class itself. So after that, we will see this holds actually, this equality holds for measurable sets.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So where the infimum is taken over all the open sets O. O containing E. So this is called outer regularity of exterior measure actually. So if you cover E, any open set O, so like all possible covering you take, and then you take the measure of like infimum of those open set, then that will coincide with outer regularity, this property, outer regularity of exterior measure. If E equal to E1 and distance of E1, E2 is bigger than 0. Distance is actually like if you take infimum of X minus Y such that distance of X minus Y is equal to X belongs to E1 and Y belongs to E2, infimum. So this is bigger than 0, then we have additivity actually. M of E equal to E1 plus M star of E2. So finally, so this is same as theorem one actually, in the sense of outer measure, exterior measure. E is countable union of disjoint, in that case this is true, intervals, that is E equal to union of J equal to 1 to infinity ij, then M star of summation J equal to 1 to infinity length of ij. Therefore, by theorem 1, we see that the exterior measure. Go ahead. So from this property we see that, by also from theorem 1 and this property we see that the exterior measure of open set, since open set can be written hello.
Yes, sir.
Sum of length of the intervals in the beginning what you said, like, so our aim is to generalize the notion called length to any arbitrary subset of R actually, but our generalization is correct for open set. So from this property we can see that for open set it is working, like whatever we just earlier, it's working. So now we want to define, I mean, precise thing. I mean, so length is like countable attitude of intervals. Then you, the length of the union is sum of the. We want same thing to happen for measure also, but this exterior measure so will not have that property for all the subsets, but it has some that particular property for some class of subsets. So those class are called measurable set. Now I am going to define the class actually. So with the definition, I mean, how we define that. So before that, I will give a remark. I won't write, I may say this remark. The property 4 and 5 will not hold for arbitrary sets. Those sets are like highly irregular. I mean, property, so like what I am trying to say is property 4 and 5 does not hold for any arbitrary general sets. That's what the remark is. So now I will define measurable set or Lebesgue measurable set. Lebesgue measure or simply measure. There are a number of different ways of defining this measurability, but this actually any definition, if we define like those are equivalent, probably we try to define a simplest way, more intuitive way, which is the following definition. A subset is Lebesgue measurable if for any epsilon bigger than 0 there exists an open set E subset of O and M star of O minus are equal to epsilon. So for any epsilon, if we can able to find an open set O which contains the set the sub M star of O minus E. This minus is set difference actually. So the elements which are belongs to O but does not belong to E, those set measure is outer measure is less than epsilon. If this happens, then we call that set E as a measurable. We define it measure as M of E, denote it measure as M of E, which is equal to M star. So if E is measurable, we define its measure M of E by M of E equal to outer measure of E. We have already definition of definition for outer measure. So this is called regularity of measure actually. This definition itself counts. So usually in many books they define measure in a different way. So that is due to Carathotri. So I'll give that definition also, but probably we are going to use the first definition, the regularity definition, but I will define via character-tree definition. Yes, sir. In R is measurable one has so for any subset A, we have this. If we have this property, then we say E is E measure of outer measure of E intersection A plus M star of E complement intersection A holds for any subset E for every subset A subset of R. If this is true, then we say the subset E of R is measurable. So, but both the definitions are equivalent actually. You may refer the book actually for equivalent, the proving equivalence between these two definitions actually. So you can define any one way and proceed using that definition. And later, if you want, you can like prove this equivalence and try to use other definitions also if you require for some particular theorem or some any other solving problems. So now we will give some properties of Lebesgue measure. So as usual, without proof actually, I mean, if you prove it, those things will take a lot of time actually. So I'm not discussing the proof actually. So, okay. So first one is very trivial actually. So open set, every open set in R is measurable. So this is easy because we are defining measurability in terms of open set actually. So in that case, we can take the open set O is E itself actually. So if we take that, the difference is empty. So we know that the difference measure of the empty set is zero actually. Any countable set is zero. In fact, empty set is zero. So then we for any given epsilon, we have that actually. We have that open set, the O itself. So this is very easy. But also, second one, or I can write one A. These two are same actually. If you prove this, then you can prove this also. Every. So this is coming from definition, but closed set is little bit tricky, but we can prove it actually. This comes. So second property is if M star of E equal to zero, outer measure is zero for some subset, then that those subsets are measurable. This is also easily follows from the definition. In fact, this is true for any subset of measure zero set. If outer measure of E is zero and F is subset of E, then that F is also measurable. F is also measurable and measure of outer measure of, I mean measure measurable. So measure of F equal to measure of E equal to 0. So as a consequence, we know that the Cantor set has measure 0, outer measure 0. Therefore, Cantor set is measurable. Therefore, Cantor set E is measurable. And has measure 0. And any countable set also measurable. That's also right. So third one, this is very important property. Any countable union of measurable set. Is measurable. So I'll prove this fact because this is very important. So suppose E equal to union of J equal to 1 to infinity EJ, where all EJ are measurable, where EJ measurables. So then given epsilon bigger than 0, we want to prove so there exists open set O such that O minus E is less than epsilon. So given epsilon bigger than 0, we may choose. So since EJ is measurable, by definition of measurability, for every epsilon we have some subset open set OJ such that we may choose for each J an open set OJ with EJ subset of OJ. This is because of the measurability of EJs, and M star of EJ, OJ minus EJ. OJ minus EJ is less than or equal to epsilon divided by 2 to the power J. Then the union. So consider the candidate as a union, so required candidate. We are choosing it as union of all these sets. Is open. So arbitrary union of open set is open. This is just countable union. So this is open set. And we know that since OJ contain EJ and union of OJs contain E. So E contain inside O. And we now want to say outer measure of O minus E is less than epsilon. So also E contained in O, also we can see that O minus E contained inside union of J equal to 1 to infinity OJ minus EJ. So we are taking difference between OJ and EJ and taking all the unions, and left side we just considering O minus E, since both the containment is there, OJ inside O and EJ inside E, this so after this containment we have by monotonicity. So we saw the property city suburbativity, and we are going to use those properties. Monotonicity, suburbativity of outer measure or exterior measure, exterior measure implies or implies O minus E is less than or equal to, this is by monotonicity. Okay, so M star of union of J equal to 1 to infinity OJ minus EJ. Now by using countable subadditivity, we have M star of summation J equal to 1 to infinity M star of OJ minus EJ. By definition, we choose an M star of OJ minus EJ as less than or equal to epsilon by 2 to the power J. So summation J equal to 1 to infinity, and this sum is equal to epsilon. So this is less than or equal to epsilon. This is what we want to prove actually. So this open set O is just union of OJs actually. So epsilon is already given. We have now we found an open set O such that M star of O minus E is less than or equal to epsilon. So by definition, E is measurable actually. E equal to union of measurable sets. Is measurable. So therefore, countable union of measurable set is measurable. So that property we have proved. So now fourth property is the complement of a measurable set. Set is measurable. Okay. So I don't want to give proof for this thing because it will take time. But it requires measurability of closed set and countable union, the property 3. So if you use both property 1a and property 3, we can prove this fact actually. So I'm leaving this as an exercise. You can try it. And the next property, fifth property is, so I'm defining this number or okay number. So okay, property 4. Okay. Countable intersection of measurable set is measurable. Proof follows from property 3 and property 5 by this thing actually. M of M star of So using De Morgan's theorem, we can follow this set actually. Intersection I equal to 1 to infinity, EJ equal to union of J equal to 1 to infinity, EJ complement, the full complement. So we know that countable union of measurable set is measurable. So, and complement of the measurable set is measurable. So, if you use that, this will follow. So, right hand side will be measurable set. So, therefore, left hand side is measurable. So, now we want to define sigma algebra. So whatever we proved, the properties of measurable set will be a very good structure actually called sigma algebra. A sigma algebra of bits is a collection of subsets of R. So not only real number, we can define sigma as you prefer, any set actually. That is closed under following things. Under countable union, sigma algebra of sets is a collection of subsets of R that is closed under countable union, countable intersections, section and complement. So now we know that set of all measurable functions, set consists of all Lebesgue measurable sets in R form sigma algebra. Remark. So first of all, power set of R forms a sigma algebra. So that is trivially known actually. All the subsets of R that forms a sigma algebra. So this is like the second example is non-trivial. Set of all the set consists of all measurable sets. So this is from property 3, 4, and 5. We know that this forms a sigma algebra. So another sigma algebra which plays a crucial role in analysis is Borel sigma algebra. So that the way we define Borel sigma algebra is smallest sigma algebra which contains Borel sigma algebra. That contain all open subsets of R. Open sets. In fact, if you have a set with topology, you can define the sigma algebra. So then you know what are all the open sets. So then you define the same definition, that smallest sigma algebra which contains all open. So this is more general, but now we are defining in R actually, so which contains all open subsets of R. So elements of the sigma algebra are called Borel. R called Borel. So I'll give you a small exercise, but this need some other things actually, like Cantor, like sets, all those things. But you find the solution for this exercise in Rider. So this question. So do there exist Lebesgue measurable? So this is equivalence actually. So if you have a sigma algebra, then there will be a measure whose so if you consider all measurable set, that is exactly that sigma algebra. So if you have a measure, on the other hand, if you have a measure, then set of all measurable sets forms a sigma algebra. The converse also true actually. If you have a sigma algebra, then there will be a measure containing this sigma algebra. So what I'm asking is, do there exist Lebesgue measurable sets which are not Borel actually? So which is smallest sigma algebra actually? Does there exist a Lebesgue measurable set which is contained in bigger sigma algebra, that is set consists of all measurable sets, but not contained in this Borel sigma algebra. So this is what this exercise. This is interesting actually, but you need the construction of Cantor-like sets and Cantor. So I will do in the last class if someone is interested. I am interested in this theorem. So this is what our aim, but this is proof of measurable. So R countable collection of disjoint if E1, E2, etc. are disjoint measurable, countable collection of disjoint measurable sets, and E equal to union of J equal to 1 to infinity EJ. Then measure of E equal to summation J equal to 1 to infinity measure of E. So this is true for measurable sets, but the existence of non-measurable sets shows that this is not true for all subsets of R. So if it is, if those subsets are measurable, then these are like countable additive. So if E is a disjoint union of disjoint collection union of countable sets, countable measurable sets, then the measure of E equal to summation J equal to 1 to infinity M of EJ. So another one, so I'm not going to prove this theorem also, but this is very important theorem in measure theory. So another important property of measure is Lebesgue measure is translation invariant. That is, if E is a subset of R and H belongs to R, then E plus H equal to set of all X plus H such that X belongs to E. Then suppose E is measurable. Then measure of E equal to measure of E plus H. So this is also another important. Okay, so I may stop now. I will start tomorrow with the definition of measurable function, and I will do some properties of it. Then I will do Riemann integration for tomorrow, and Riemann integration, some properties about Riemann integration, and so Riemann integration fails to have some property. I will show that. Then I will do the integration in measure theory. And so if you go in measure theory way, those properties are true, but those are not true for Riemann integration. Like some properties are there. So I will discuss those things tomorrow. And I will first define measurable function. Then I will go to Riemann. Yeah.
Sir?
Yes, ma'am. So I'm finished.
Okay, sir. Tomorrow we'll see, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your nice lecture. If any participants, please ask if you have any question.
Or I'm going too fast, or too slow, or too messy. Like any comments, I will try to correct it.
I think there is no questions from audience. Participants, please. Okay, sir. See you tomorrow, sir. Tomorrow session.
Yeah, tomorrow session.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.